next matter to come before the court this morning is State of Ohio versus Amanda Roberts. Both sides will have 15 minutes to present oral argument. If you're the appellant and wish to reserve any time for oral argument, you may reserve up to 5 minutes for rebuttal. Please let me know when you get started. I'm keeping the clock. You can also see that it's on the wall over there. The arguments are being recorded, so please keep your voices up and stay behind the podium. And do not mention the names of children or any victims of crime, which you can refer to as either victim or whatever the case may be. The judges have read your briefs and we're ready to proceed with your honor.
Thank you, Your Honors.
Would you like to reserve any time for rebuttal?
I'll do 2 minutes, Your Honor. May it please the court, my name is Julie Toth. I am the attorney representing the appellant, Amanda Roberts, in this case. Good morning, Your Honors. This action involves the calculation of time and subsequent violation of appellant's speedy trial rights. Appellant respectfully requests that the decision of the court below be reversed for these reasons. Appellant's speedy trial rights were violated when the state dismissed and refiled based on the same information and knowledge they had at the time of the original charge. Her waiver of time in the original case does not apply to the refiled case, and that the trial court erred in denying appellant's motion to dismiss on the refiled case. My client was charged with an OBI in December of 2020, and the case proceeded through the court. In the initial case, trial counsel waived time and proceeded through arraignment, pretrial, and was dismissed at the suppression hearing due to the unavailability of the state's witness. This happened in March 2021. In June of 2021, the state refiled the OBI almost 3 months later. This wasn't based on any new or additional information. It was all the same information that they had at the time of the arrest. She did not waive the time in the new case, so it wouldn't apply. And we filed a motion to dismiss with the trial court based on the speedy trial issues, which were denied. It is our position that her speedy trial rights were violated by this, Your Honors, and that under the Constitution, both the state and federal Constitution, and that the 90 days have passed. So we are asking that the court dismiss the OBI, reverse and dismiss it.
The motion to submit attached to your brief, I believe, just raised the issue of the constitutional speedy trial right. Are there some other document you raised where you raised the statutory speedy trial right?
In the trial court area?
Yes.
Based on the record, I'm not sure, Your Honor. We would refer to the speedy trial under the statute, which is under Ohio Revised Code 2945.71. In the briefs, we do outline, it becomes more of a math problem and figuring out the days based on any waiver or time told. If you refer to the brief, we do have that outlined.
In the trial court in the second case, before you refiled your motion to suppress, it's automatically got a suppression hearing, it seems to me. Is that what happened?
I believe so. That there was a date set and we filed suppression.
Right. It seemed to me there was a date set and then you filed your motion to suppress. They just appreciated it had been filed in the earlier case, it seemed to me, and just moved towards setting a hearing. Is that your recollection of what the procedure was?
That is my recollection, Your Honor.
Seeing that there are no other questions, may continue, or you will be able to reserve up to 5 minutes for rebuttal.
Okay. I'll go ahead and reserve for rebuttal.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Good morning, Your Honors, and may it please the court. Kirsten Smith for the State of Ohio. Your Honors, this court should affirm the decision of the trial court denying Ms. Roberts' motion to dismiss for two reasons. The First, Ms. Roberts has not preserved the issue of her statutory speedy trial rights for appeal. And second, Ms. Roberts entered a plea and was sentenced by the trial court prior to the expiration of the 90-day statutory speedy trial clock in this case. In the trial court, Ms. Roberts' motion to dismiss focused solely on the constitutional speedy trial grounds. At no time in the trial court did she raise statutory speedy trial rights. This court has held that the failure to preserve a statutory speedy trial argument by not raising it at or prior to the commencement of trial means that the defendant has waived that argument on appeal and is limited to a plain error argument. Ms. Roberts has not made a plain error argument in her brief, and this court has long held that it will not construct an argument on an appellant's behalf.
Does the motion at the trial level talk about the 90 days? Does it reference the statute in that way?
I don't believe it does. It just says constitutional speedy trial rights. It's a very brief motion that was filed, but I'm not 100% sure whether it does mention 90 days. Therefore, you know, she hasn't argued plain error, and this court should disregard her assignment of error. Regardless of that, there was no statutory speedy trial violation in this case. As appellant's counsel mentioned, there was a dismissal of a first case and a refiling of charges. However, in the first case, Ms. Roberts filed a waiver that was unlimited in duration and listed no starting point. This court is held in State v. Buck that when a waiver of time does not indicate a starting point, it is deemed effective from the first day. So none of the time in her first case counted towards the statutory 90 days. Additionally, the Ohio Supreme Court has held in State v. Broughton that none of the time between dismissal and refiling of charges counts on the speedy trial clock unless the defendant is held in jail or released on bond. She was not arrested in this case, so that's obviously not applicable here. Therefore, the 90 days did not actually start until the refiling of her second case, which I believe was on June 3rd, 2021. At that time, it did appear that the court assumed that the motion to suppress from the first case was still pending, so it set a suppression hearing for July 1st. However, on June 25th, the state made a motion to continue that until July 13th, which was a tolling event under revised code 2945.72H. The motion does indicate that both parties agreed to the July 13th date, and the reasons for the continuous were that new medical records were made available and both parties needed time to review them prior to the suppression hearing. Therefore, that was a tolling event under the statute for 12 days.
You don't think there was any tolling event prior to that due to the fact the court scheduled a hearing on their motion to suppress, even though it wasn't filed in that case, which seemed like somewhat odd procedure, but that's what they were doing.
Your Honor, the record doesn't reflect that, and my reading of the statute is that only a defense motion filed tolls the event. So for that purpose, we haven't argued that, you know, time was still tolling, just because there technically was not a motion on the record in this case until they refiled it on July 12th. And that tolling event ran concurrently with the continuance, so it wouldn't really count for purposes of the speedy trial.
So it was the state's request for a continuance, and you're asserting that defense, it tolls because they agreed to the date?
They agreed to the date, and the reason for the continuance was also a reasonable thing for them to have more time to review these newly filed records. Additionally, Ms. Roberts didn't argue in the trial court or here on appeal that that continuance was unreasonable, which this court in State v. Berner has held that the reasonable is evidenced by defendant's lack of objection to a motion for the state to continue. Additionally, Ms. Roberts also did file a motion to dismiss on the constitutional speedy trial grounds. Unfortunately, the denial of that
that motion does not have a date on it. But given that the state did file a response the following day, we're arguing that that would have told time for at least 2 days in this matter. And finally, following the denial of the motion to dismiss, Ms. Roberts filed a motion for reconsideration, another tolling event under 294572E, which was effectively denied 7 days later when the court entered a judgment of conviction in the matter. Therefore, time was tolled for a total of 21 days in this matter, and Ms. Roberts was sentenced well within the 90-day speedy trial.
Did those second two motions that were filed, did they result in a change of the trial date, or the trial date of September whatever always stayed the same despite the motion filed by defendant towards the end of the case?
The trial court was moved from August to September at one point. The record does not reflect why that occurred.
Was that while the motion was pending or after the motion was pending, do you know?
It's not clear at what point the trial was rescheduled. I can imagine, I believe the date they filed the motion to dismiss was the trial date. So that's a possible explanation, but again, it's not in the record. So unless there are any further questions, I would ask that this court affirm the judgment of the trial court and overrule Ms. Roberts' assignment of error.
Thank you, counsel. Attorney Toki, you have 5 minutes for rebuttal.
Thank you.
That she was charged with this offense at the end of December of 2020, that there was a concern about the 3 months in between the dismissal and the refile. It's not clear why it took the state that long to file new charges since there was the same information, but we believe that that is in direct violation of her constitutional rights. Therefore, Your Honors, we are requesting that this court reversed the lower court's decision. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you both for your presentations today. The court will take the matter under advisement. We will issue a written decision, which will be mailed to all parties in this appeal, as well as posted on the House Supreme Court website. Again, thank you.